What is up, people? Thanks for tuning into this episode of OTR Frankie. In this one, I chat with Remington Leith Kropp, lead singer of Canadian-American rock band Palaye Royale. Remington started the band back in 2008 with his two brothers, Sebastian and Emerson. Since then, the band has been on the road practically non-stop, initially playing anywhere they could to touring with the likes of Enter Shikari, Rob Zombie, and Marilyn Manson. 2020 had been a pretty busy year for the band, with their latest album, The Bastards, releasing in May, and being nominated for a Juno for Breakthrough Artist of the Year. Remington and I chat about the new album, dive a little deeper into some of the songs, and go over some questions from fans on the R Palaye Royale subreddit. I hope you enjoy. This shit messes with my head. The only home I know is my bed. I know over the last 4 years, you guys have done over 700 concerts. You are definitely a touring band.
Yes, we are.
So all of this must have been a huge shock to the system, because you're going from being super busy to not being allowed to do anything.
Yeah, it was definitely a very different situation for us, you know, because we're obviously like the road technically really is my home. Mm-hmm. So the stage is kind of like my bedroom.
Yeah.
So it's definitely being a different vibe, but it's, you know, it's giving us the time to, you know, actually like, you know, see our mom, you know, for the first time in a little bit, you know, right. And then also just like start working on the more music for everybody. So, you know, that's what we're excited about, being home for that aspect of things.
Cool. So you're making the best of it. That's good.
Yeah.
Any new hobbies? I know like baking bread is something a lot of people are doing and stuff like that.
New hobbies. I'm becoming very handy around the house. I'm building some really strange things, and I'm just like, I'm becoming very handy with a hammer and nail. So.
Oh, cool. What kind of stuff are you building?
I was working on something called, it's like a pergola. It's like, okay, a canopy thing.
Cool.
So yeah, putting that up a couple days ago. That was definitely the first time. I definitely got extremely frustrated trying to put it up. So I'm trying to work on it for 6 months, and I finally had the time.
Oh, wicked. That's great. yeah. What about like Netflix? Are you binging any shows or anything like that? Any movies?
Yeah. So, I've just been watching, like, so I had like a National Treasure marathon, and then Da Vinci Code last night. So yeah, I'm all about the movies.
Cool, man. Cool. Has the quarantine like affected your creativity or songwriting in like a positive or negative way, or is it kind of like the same now? Or
it has been good, because like I've been like playing a lot more of piano, because I've been playing piano since I've been a kid.
Cool.
So I've been like writing a lot more on piano, because, you know, we're usually on the road. Like, I don't really have, there's not many pianos around. There's just maybe just like a sink, just like a little synth, or just like a guitar around. So this is the first time I'm like writing on piano. So I'm really happy about that.
Oh, cool. That's great. Well, yeah, let's talk about the new album. So The Bastards released on May 29th. I was just wondering what was different in the making of this album. Were you guys working with new producers, or
it was the same producer? I just we definitely started using, you know, all the work that we've been doing over the past 4 years, because Boom Boom Room Side A and Side B, those songs have been written for maybe 5 years. So mm-hmm. this is kind of like, I felt like, you know, that was kind of like our high school stuff, and this is kind of like our college stuff, you know, so we just wanted to take it one step further.
Right.
And, you know, it was just different, especially, you know, lyrically. This was like the first time, you know, we didn't really like dance around anything. We just kind of like were completely honest with ourselves, which mm-hmm. was like the most important through the music, and, you know, just telling our story and kind of all the shit that we've gone through. And that was the first time we really opened up like that. And it was definitely a frightening experience, because, you know, you're letting yourself open to be judged. But I think that's where the best music and most honest lyrics come from, is from complete honesty.
Yeah, definitely. I totally get that. So I know you guys mentioned that you all had hands in writing, well, the music overall, but I think everyone wrote a couple of songs specifically on the album. Which ones did you write?
The ones that I really had a foot in was Tonight Is the Night I Die, Redeemer, Black Sheep, Lonely, and then Nightmares.
Cool. And which is your favorite off the album? If you had to pick one song that you're like, this is the one that I'm most proud of.
Definitely Redeemer. That's definitely my most proud. Yeah, that's Wicked, I'm, yeah. I'm
I love that song too.
Yeah, I'm extremely proud. That was it was definitely like tough to get through. Yeah, it was definitely it was tough recording because, you know, we wanted to go so many different directions. Mm-hmm. You know, we had a couple arguments in the band about what direction we wanted to take the song, but I knew that we had to, like, I really wanted it to be very, very cinematic, almost, you know, big orchestral, you know, kind of like larger than life type of, you know, recording. That's what I really wanted out of the song.
Cool. Tell me about, well, I had an interesting conversation with the last band that I, or one of the last bands that I interviewed, and just talking about how they had also just finished an album. They were on their, these guys were a bit smaller, so their North American tour, but you guys were on a world tour, and suddenly everything comes to a crashing stop. Was it like, were you guys like freaked out and like, shit, we got to get home ASAP? Like, what was that like?
Yeah, there was, you know, I think we were in that moment where Trump literally said he's stopping all flights coming into the United States. I think it was like at Friday at midnight. And, you know, that we were in, I think, like Budapest maybe on like Thursday. And that's when we heard about it. And so we're like, holy shit, we got to get on a flight back. And then he was not very specific in his address. He didn't say like U.S. citizens can come in anytime. So,
right.
We didn't really figure that out until we landed and canceled the tour already. So we were kind of upset about that. But, you know, safety first for, you know, everyone is attending the shows. So, you know, we were super bummed, but we're just so grateful we got at least to do most of the European leg of the tour.
Right. Sorry, I just wanted to jump back to Redeemer. You said it was Redeemer, right? That was the one that you're... Most proud of,
yeah.
Cool. Well, why don't we, just because you brought that one up, let's dissect it a little bit. So tell me what the song's about.
Like the elevator song, pitch. I was in Paris about, I think 2017 with Emerson, and you know, one of my good friends, Lil Peep, he passed. Mm-hmm. He died, and we figured we got the news when I was in Paris. And so I wrote that song for him.
Okay.
Yeah, so it was just, it was kind of like, his death really, like, it kind of, it really did take a toll on, you know, me and Emerson, because, you know, he just turned 21, and he had so much fucking talent, and
yeah,
it was just so heartbreaking to see someone, you know, it was so much fucking potential, just like, you know, just, you know, be gone, and so it really broke my heart, And so, yeah, we were in Paris, and me and Emerson were just drinking a bunch of absinthe, and then we wrote that song for him.
Right. And why did you want it? Is this why you wanted it to be like a bigger orchestral kind of sound to it, just because it had such a deep connection to you?
Yeah, I just wanted people to really focus on the lyrics, you know, really, you really like listen to what I'm saying instead of being distracted by like a huge band aspect of things. You know, that's why even in the first verse, it's mainly just vocals in there with just like some undertones, mm-hmm. you know, so you can really listen to the lyrics and really get into, you know, what I'm saying.
Right. Right. Cool. Well, I also know that you guys got nominated for a Juno it's a Breakthrough Group of the Year. Obviously, the Junos didn't happen. Tell me about that. How did that feel, like getting like kind of like something from back home, getting some recognition?
That definitely, you know, we've been dreaming of that since, you know, we've been kids, you know, so that was like fucking huge honor, but it's been a great fucking year, even though all this bullshit, you know, what's going on in the world today. It's been a good year for us, weirdly, because mm-hmm. even in like Canada, we got the number one rock record over there and number one alternative record, I think. So, yeah, it's been a huge year. And so I know the Junos are in like 6 days, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So that gets announced. So, you know, fingers crossed, I'm hoping we get it.
Yeah, man, that'd be awesome, honestly. And just tell me, where did you guys grow up in Canada?
Well, my parents grew up in Toronto.
Okay.
And then they had Sebastian in Toronto. And then right before I was born, they moved to Vegas.
Gotcha. And why Vegas?
Yeah, so I grew up in Vegas pretty much my whole life. But, you know, we constantly went back to Canada, you know, just go see family and everything.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And are most people still in, is family still based in Toronto or around Toronto?
Oh, yeah. All the cousins, aunts, uncles, everyone's still over there.
Cool. Cool. And then I know you guys got your name from, it's funny, actually, the Palaye Royale is probably a 5 minute walk from where I'm sitting right now. It's
oh, no way.
Yeah. When I read that, I was like, no way. That's crazy. So that's really cool. Why did you guys decide on this? I know that's where your grandparents met, but is there a deeper story behind that?
Well, it's definitely, you know, it's where the grandparents met. And, you know, I think that was just so important, you know, cause the band is just the three brothers and, you know, we wanted to, you know, ensure that, you know, it kind of, it always stays family, I guess, in a weird way. And, you know, we, you know, we're nothing, you know, without our family. So it's just us three forever. So we just wanted to ensure that instead of giving it, you know, another name, we wanted something that really holds, you know, us together as brothers, you know.
Right. Ah, that's lovely. That's such a nice message. So you guys formed as the band back in 2008, from what I could find, but I'm sure you've been making music kind of like all your lives growing up.
Yeah, definitely. Music has been a part of my life. It's been my life, you know. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't really imagine doing anything else with it. I started piano when I was about 2 years old, and then our mom said to us when I was about like 10, they're like, okay, you guys can choose another instrument. And I went straight to drums. And I was like, yes, I want to play the drums. And Emerson, he's like, oh no, Emerson already said he wants to play the drums. I'm like, okay, I'll do guitar. Mm-hmm. And Sebastian's like, oh no, I already picked guitar. I'm like, oh, fuck. I'm like, I did not want to be a singer at all. So I'm an extremely shy person. And so that was kind of like my worst fear, was being in front of a group of people. And then, you know, the first couple shows were definitely extremely hard on me, you know, right, just trying to get out of my shell. But I'm so glad I did it, you know.
Yeah.
Because it's I couldn't imagine my life without, you know, singing and creating. And it's my favorite thing to do. And honestly, I kind of like being the center of attention now. I'm just like a narcissist now.
It kind of molded you into who you are today.
Exactly, yeah.
How did you overcome that fear of singing in front of people? I mean, that's not, like, I can't even do karaoke.
Trust me, it was definitely, I think it was my first like piano recital or something, you know. It was like my first time having to sing. I think it was like in tears for like, I was only like 10 or 11 at the time.
Right.
But I was just in tears. I was so scared to be in front of people because, you know, I thought everyone was going to judge me, and, you know, that was just a huge fear of mine, you know, just being judged. And it definitely took so much practice. I don't think I got comfortable in my own skin probably until I was like 20, right, 21. Maybe. So yeah, it took like a decade.
Yeah.
I got.
Cool. Do you think that with you guys being brothers, that's got to be a very, like, an even more special connection than most bands have, just because I'm sure the honesty level and just, you know, you guys can like cut through the shit right away. If you're not liking something someone's doing, you just go ahead and say it. Do you think that's like really helped form what you guys have become?
Oh yeah. We do not care about each other's feelings. If something we do not like, we will tell them immediately. We're just so rude to each other, but it cuts out all the bullshit. So it works.
Right. That's cool. So I know, you know, over the years you've had the opportunity to tour with so many people, you know, Marilyn Manson, Rob Zombie, Enter Shikari, to name a few. Who was the most fun to tour with?
Oh, that's a tough one. I loved touring with Manson. That was so much fun. We became friends on the tour, so just hanging out with him every night. That was definitely the coolest thing, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, because I watched him growing up on fucking MTV, and it was definitely the most wild thing, you know, just hanging out with him every night, just, you know, having a couple drinks, and then just him just telling me like the craziest stories, and just hanging with him. He's a great guy.
Cool. Yeah, that definitely comes through. I could totally tell from any interview he's been in. I'm just like, he just seems so cool.
Yeah, he's definitely, he's a fucking sweetheart. I love him.
So being a band that tours so much, I would imagine you guys have figured out really cool and good ways to kill the time when you're on the road. What's some of the stuff that you guys do?
On the road? Yeah, we do get like sometimes, but mostly we're so busy on the road. Like we literally have like 6-7 hour days, just, you know, from VIPs to then the meet and greets and then sound check, the show, and then trying not to drink too much after the show. but we usually fill our time, you know, just trying to write as much as we can. Because, mm-hmm. you know, we take the sound checks for like maybe like an hour or two a day, just trying to write new music.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so we definitely try to take advantage of it.
That's cool. All right, and then I'm going to get to a segment that I've kind of created just because I actually get a lot of my more like in-depth questions off Reddit, just because every band has a subreddit, and your fans gave me a lot of good questions, so we'll get into that in a little bit. But so last question from me is, who's the... name some of like the most recent artists or bands you've discovered.
Most recent. I love Bishop Briggs. She's just fucking amazing. Huge fan of her music. You know, we've been talking, you know, possibly maybe doing a song together. So,
oh, that'd be exciting.
So yeah. So I definitely a huge fan of her. He's a little outrageous, but his music is fucking unbelievable. I'm just a huge fan. It's Oliver Tree.
Yes. Oh, I love Oliver Tree.
Oliver Tree, I fucking love everything he's doing. He's just, he's so funny, and he's so amazing. The fucking, he just puts out some bangers. I love
him. Oh, man. And his music videos, they kill me every time. The latest one where he has the nutsack on his chin.
It was just so outrageous, but I'm like, you know what? I wouldn't expect anything less than that, you know?
Exactly. Yeah, that's so Oliver Tree. That's so funny. Cool. All right, Remington, we're getting into the Reddit ass section. So... these are in no order at all. I'm also going to probably bastardize most of these usernames, but this one's from Zesty5724. What's the scariest thing to ever happen on tour?
Scariest thing to ever happen. Oh, okay. Yeah, definitely when we were first starting out, we just moved out of our mom's car, you know, to touring. And then we found this broken down airport shuttle bus. It had like 400,000 miles on it or something. So it was definitely on the last leg of its life. So we were driving to Texas, and during that, you know, the whole car catches on fire while we're on the freeway. So that was scary. We stop in a gas station. And then, so me and Emerson are sleeping in the back. Everybody goes out and gets snacks. And the parking brake breaks off. And then we start rolling through like four lanes of traffic, unknowingly. God. We're about to hit another gas station across the street. And luckily, I woke up in time right before we slammed into the convenience store. So that was, luckily, we didn't get hit rolling through the lanes of traffic. I have no idea how. Could have easily gotten hit by a semi.
Wow.
And then to top it off on that same tour, you know, we were just like taking a left-hand turn, and then we just see one of our tires just completely fly down the road, and we're like, is that our tire? And then we're like, well, a little bit, and then the whole car just crashes over, and we're just like, okay, that's it for the shuttle bus.
Yeah, I guess we're getting back in mom's car.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, that's crazy. All right, so this one comes from Void747. What were the crowds like headlining your own shows versus opening for, say, Marilyn Manson or Rob Zombie?
Oh, it's definitely different, you know. You know, we're playing, you know, I think it was like 20,000 people every night with Manson and Zombie. And then, you know, we jumped to, you know, it's still great. We're doing like 2,000 people just on our own, but just everyone's singing the song. It's just like, you know, sometimes I can't even hear because of how loud the screams are. Oh, and it's just the greatest fucking energy in the world.
Oh, that must be such an incredible feeling. I know being like part of a crowd when that happens is awesome. So just being up there and hearing that.
Oh, it's like there's sometimes, you know, well, you know, we're three grown men at this point. Obviously, you know, regardless, we'll wear makeup and fancy clothes, but you know, it brought us the fucking tears. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a couple times we were singing like just dying in a hot tub, and the whole crowd is just singing back one of the bridge to us, and we all just look at each other and we just start fucking just tearing up, and it was one of the most emotional things. So yeah, it's been happening a lot. It's been crazy.
Oh, congratulations, man. That's an amazing milestone and feeling to have. That's great.
Oh, thank you.
All right, so this one comes from rleaf1. Any insight on deeper meaning behind either the songs or the album in general is one thing I'm interested in.
Can I say it again?
So I guess he's just asking for, or they are asking for, just a deeper insight behind the album or any one of the songs. I guess we went into that with Redeemer, but maybe the album as a whole?
Yeah, the album as a whole was kind of, it's a concept record based off of a comic book. But we've had these songs kind of prepared in our minds for a long time. So we've been like songs kind of like leading to this record for the past 6 years. Mm-hmm. So you'll be hearing like some words used and everything. So that was
Oh, sorry, Remington. I think I lost you.
Hi, Remington?
Yeah, hi.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, yeah. Can you hear me?
Sorry, yeah. You cut out. You cut out there. Yeah, I think I got that things are based on a comic book, and then you started cutting out.
Oh yeah, so things are based off the comic book, and then you know, kind of just going back and forth. You know, we've been dropping like little Easter egg hunts through the past 6 years of our work.
Mm-hmm. What comic book?
So the comic books, we just dropped 14 pages of the first act, and then the rest of the comic should be coming out, I think, in a couple months. And so when you read the comic while listening to the record, everything kind of adds up and makes sense, like certain songs.
Very cool. Very cool. I like that a lot. That's awesome. Cool. All right. I got three more for you if we still got time.
Yeah.
All right, so this one's from D-Drox. Any tips for meeting people you look up to? And then in brackets, tips if, say, we were to meet you at a meet and greet.
Tips to, you know, I'm not very good when meeting people because I fangirl over, you know, a certain amount of people as well. So, I remember, you know, going backstage because I went with Francis Bean Cobain.
Okay.
To the My Camera Union show.
Wow.
And so she took me there, and I'm like, obviously a huge Nirvana fan, number one.
Yeah.
And then in My Cam as well. So that was definitely one of the craziest nights of my life. And she's like, you want to go backstage? And I was like, okay. And then so I go have a conversation with Mikey for like 10 minutes, and I'm just like, I'm just trying not to like internally freak out.
Yeah.
So it was definitely I just did not have any words at that point, so that was definitely a crazy moment.
Do you think you did okay?
I hope I did okay. Well, exchanged like numbers over Instagram, so now we're texting. So that was definitely good.
Oh, cool. Okay, good. All right. Yeah,
I didn't freak him out too much. So it's stay calm. I tried not to scream. It was really difficult, but I tried not to scream.
Yeah, I know. I've definitely through this have had that moment when I got to interview Dennis, the lead singer of Refused, which is like a band that I grew up listening to, and I was I was like in their tour bus doing this interview and just trying. I'm just like, just don't say something stupid. Don't make yourself like, please don't embarrass us. Don't embarrass us, Frank. And I think I did okay. Like but it's definitely, it's so nerve wracking meeting someone that you look up to. And every time coming out of it, I'm always just like, oh, they're just a person. They're just a person exactly. At the end of the day. Right.
Yeah. So there's definitely, if I ever meet, you know, Mick Jagger, then, I think I'll just, you know, just completely lose it.
Yeah, I'd just be tongue-tied for sure.
Yeah.
cool. This one comes from Nico the Alien. Would you rather fight 10 chicken-sized horses or a horse-sized chicken?
Horse-sized chicken.
And why?
I honestly have no idea. It just seems better.
I feel that. Okay, and then the last one here is from Your Average Loner. This one's more of a statement. They just say, tell them I love them so much and that they've helped me get through a lot, especially lonely, which I relate to. Also ask them what they think... Also ask them what they think about how the songs... When people tell them the songs helped save their lives.
Yeah, that's, you know, whenever I hear that, it's definitely an emotional thing. Cause like, you know, so I think that was the biggest thing for us as a band for this record, you know, was just to be kind of completely honest and, you know, talk about all the shit that we've gone through in our lives. Mm-hmm. So it could help, you know, all these kids going through something similar going, oh shit, you know, they went through the same things that I did. And, you know, I think it can get better, you know, you can get past your own past, really. Mm-hmm. So it was definitely tough to like put it out into the world, but you know, I think it's going to be for better. And if I can help a couple people out, you know, I think that's the greatest feeling in the world. And I think I would have done my job.
Right. Great answer. All right. Let me see. I think that's it for the Reddit part. And I think that's it for me, Remington.
Awesome. Hey, well, thank you so much for taking the time, man.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Have a good one, man. I'll talk to you soon.
You too. Cheers. Bye.
All right. Bye.